Thank you. So, okay, so my plan is to have two lectures, one which is today about macroscopic approach, and tomorrow will be microscopic approach. But I am not sure how much I can say today, so maybe tomorrow I will talk a little more about macroscopic approach. And the first thing to say is that you have, you want to study a model or a system, and you can have both approaches, but most of the time you cannot solve the question you ask either by macroscopic or microscopic. Both approaches are too hard. Now, in some cases you can use one approach and it's an open problem to see whether you can recover it by the other approach. For example, today I will show some results that you can get by the macroscopic approach, and they are quite hard to obtain by the microscopic. And the reverse is true. And in very few cases, you can do both and check that they both agree. So let me start this macroscopic approach today. By listing a number of questions you can ask about large deviation functions. So, large deviation functions in extended systems. So what I have in mind is, for example, a lattice gas like the symmetric exclusion process, but you could have more complicated interactions. And I imagine that I have a large system and I look at it on a macroscopic scale. So for example, the SEP, you have at the microscopic level particles which hope with some rules and some interactions. In the SEP, they just cannot jump on the same side, but otherwise you can have more general rules, and then what kind of large deviation function you might consider. The first one is here. It's if you take an open finite system, so the system is large, you have like size L, and then you look on this big scale and you imagine that you have a certain profile rho of x. The profile, and we ask what is, if you wait for very long for this system, so this system, say, is in contact with two reservoirs at two densities, rho 1 and rho 2, and you can ask what's the probability that you observe a certain profile rho of x at large scale. And this, you will define a functional which depends on the profile. Now, if you don't like functional, the way you can think of it is that you have your large system, you cut it into boxes of size small l, and you specify the number of particles in each of these boxes, and then this will be this probability will depend on the density in each of these boxes, so it will depend on the finite number of numbers, the number of boxes, and then you ask what's the probability of observing densities in these boxes. So this is the first quantity you might consider. The second one will be the empirical measure. Imagine that you look exactly at the same system, but you look at it over a certain long time period, so time T, capital T, and then you say that you look at its evolution, and during this time T, you observe an average density, empirical density, which is just the density you see during this time interval T. So let me call it rho tilde. And then you have this long time T, this large system, and then you ask what's the probability to observe this empirical measure? And this, in general, will be L times T times F tilde of rho of X, rho tilde of X. So it's a time average over a certain time interval. And you see, there is a difference here because there is not only the L, but also the time T, because the longer the time you look at, the less likely it is to observe this empirical measure. So the typical situation that you would see, so if I try to make a picture, then you would have this time interval 0t, and of course the space of profile is a very high dimensional space, but let me just try to represent it by a single variable. So here it's my profile rho tilde of x, and then here would be the typical profile when I don't condition on anything. And so essentially you want the system to do something like that, to stay around this density profile and to come back rho tilde, so to observe this empirical measure. And then you can ask all kinds of questions. For example, what would be the profile here at time zero? What would be the profile at time zero, the most likely profile that you would see? What is this, the shape of how you reach this kind of quasi-steady state? What are the fluctuations in this quasi-stationary state also? So what are the fluctuations? What is the optimal trajectory? And all kinds of things. And I'll try to discuss this. One thing that you can imagine also, when I draw this picture, is that this picture in some cases might be misleading, because in order to achieve some empirical measure, it could be preferable, instead of having during the very long time period T, a profile which is very close to this rho tilde, you could have a profile which is rather different during this time period, but such that the time average is rho tilde. So for example, you could have something which is here for part of the fraction of the time and here for another fraction of the time, in order, but still that the time average would be rho tilde. And going from the first situation to the second situation would correspond to a kind of phase transition. You can also imagine a third possibility, like for example, that you achieve this empirical measure with something which would have a certain period here. And so you have a lot of possibilities. Now, the third quantity you might consider is the large deviation function of the current, which is also some kind of empirical measure. So I have, again, my system, which is in still my finite system, which is in contact with two reservoirs, size L. And then you measure, during a certain time interval T, how many particles went inside, were left the left reservoir. You could, in fact, the place where you measure this QT is not important if you look at a very long time interval. So let me take a long capital T, say a long time interval. So whether you count the particles which enter here or which leave there is essentially the same if you take a model where particles cannot accumulate. And then you can ask, what is the probability that QT over T equals a certain J? And this will be also a large deviation function, T F of J. Let me call it, yes. And of course, it will depend on the system size. It depends on the reservoirs. And in fact, we'll see from the macroscopic fluctuation theory that I am going to discuss in more detail that for diffusive system, and for large L, then FL of J will be of the form 1 over L, a certain function, say F of LJ. So the size dependent will be given by this expression. Okay, so this is a large deviation function of the current. Here we have two large deviations of the density. Sorry? In the problem A, I am thinking in the steady state. That is, I have looked at my system and I look at it at just a given time. Any time, it's one time question. Here are time averages. No, usually they are not related, but both can be understood using the macroscopic fluctuation theory. But they are not related, and somehow, in cases where the fluctuations are like this, this is maybe the simplest quantity to consider. So in the case where the system remains very close to the empirical, that's probably the easiest question you can ask. Okay. Now, you see, in all these things, I am talking about large deviation function, but very often it's much easier to work with generating functions. So I just mentioned it. So instead of considering this large deviation function, it might be easier to consider, generating functions. To consider the average of exponential lambda of x, rho of x, maybe there is a L here, times dx minus L f of rho of x. And you see, so if you, because there is a L in front here, because there is a L in front, then it will be dominated by a certain saddle point. And so this will be exponential L some g of lambda of x. And so for the density or for the current, it might be easier to talk about generating functions than the large deviation function itself. And so this is just a small remark. Now, there are two other situations. There is one other situation which is also of interest, but which raises a new question, which is if you try to look at large deviations on an infinity system. So you don't have reservoirs, but you start with some initial condition, which could be at equilibrium or not at equilibrium, and you want to study the large deviation in an infinite system. So again, you can have in mind the symmetric exclusion process, but any other lattice gas or diffusive system. And now you can sit, for example, at the origin and ask near the origin, what is the current, the integrated current that you have observed during time t, qt? So just counting how many particles have crossed this bond in the positive direction minus in the negative direction. And of course, if you, because there is a stochastic evolution in these models, then the generating function of this QT will depend on what you start, the initial condition, the configuration at time zero. So in principle, you have this generating function or this large deviation function, which depends what you start with. And so it depends on C zero. And now, usually, you don't know precisely the initial condition, so you have certain measure on the initial condition, and then you have several choices that you can do. And in analogy with the theory of disordered systems, then you can imagine several kinds of averages, and here I quote two of them, which are, one is just the annealed the annealed average, which would be just to say, okay, the large deviation of the generating function I want to consider is just the sum over all configuration of lambda qt given c0 times the probability of the initial condition. For example, you could take a Bernoulli measure. Say initially, all sites are occupied with a given density rho, independent of the site, and then you can consider this thing, and then you say this is a generating function, and from that you extract the large deviation function by Legendre transform. But you can also do the quenched one. So you see, so when you are in the infinite system, then you have several choices even of the definition of the large deviation function. The quench would be something like that. The thing you want to average is P of C0, the log of exponential QT. So for people who have worked on the theory of disordered systems, you see that this quantity is a kind of partition function, and sometimes in disordered systems you want to take the annealed average, that is, you want to average the initial the partition function, and in most cases the most interesting situation is to average the log of the partition function, which is the free energy. And physically it corresponds to very different situations. So just to give you an idea, is that imagine that I am interested in the distribution of current for what I have drawn here. So I ask, what is the probability of observing QT? And at time t equals zero, I just say, I take a Bernoulli measure, that is, all sites are occupied with equal probability and they are not correlated. So initially, I start with at time t equals zero, I start with a certain density rho in my system. Now I want to ask what the system will do in order to produce a very large current here during a certain time t. Yes. Okay, because the probability of rho of x is exponential minus L F of rho of x. Sorry? So I integrate over the rho of x. Okay, yes, maybe writing the average was maybe confusing. Okay, so if I ask what the probability, I want to say what the system will do in order to produce a very large certain current towards the right. Now, in the quenched average, essentially it will start with this flat profile and then evolve. I will see a certain profile evolving essentially as a function of time. The system will essentially try to push particles to the right. So if I look at the system, for example, at the initial time, it will be like this. And at the final time, it will be something like this. That is, it will have pushed some of the particle on the left of the origin to the right. So this would be what you see in the quenched case. Now, so it would be rho of x at time zero, and this would be rho of x at time t. But if you look at what happens in the annealed case, in the annealed case, even at t equals zero, the profile will look like this. And at the final time, it will essentially look like that. So essentially, what happens is that when you do this average, in fact, the system tries to find, you see, to find unlikely initial condition, this sum will be dominated by unlikely initial condition. So you want to have observe a very large current, then maybe it's better to start with an unlikely initial condition and then let the system evolve in order to produce this current. But in the quench, you have no choice and you have to start with the flat profile. So this is just to give you an idea of the difference between these two averages. For the SEP or whatever, yes. Here I am talking about the SEP or WASEP or whatever. But in all cases, you will have something in the initial condition. The two averages will differ. And you have not to care about that in the finite system because the system reaches a steady state, so the initial condition is forgotten. Now, maybe a last question you can ask, maybe this was D, so people are interested often in the question of tact particles. So you have, again, this lattice gas here, and then you want to follow one particular particle, say, put a star here, which is like the other ones. And then you might be interested in looking at how this particle moves, what is the probability to find it at a position xt at time t. And then again, you have a large deviation function associated to it. And again, if you work on the infinite system, you will have different answers depending whether you look at quench or annealed averages. So these are the kind of large deviation functions that you might consider. Now let me talk about diffusive system, and then I will be able to discuss the macroscopic fluctuation theory. So, as I said, diffusive systems are systems which satisfy either Fourier's law or Fick's law. So let me talk here. I will mention both, but my discussion will be mostly on the case of Fick's law and of particles, but the story is very much the same. So I have a system of size L between these two reservoirs. And then if it satisfies Fick's law, what I have is that the current, the average current through the system will be of the form, will have a 1 over L dependence. And now if I am in a situation which is close to equilibrium, it will be proportional to the difference rho 1 minus rho 2. This is the current during time t, and then there is a coefficient here which is d of rho, and this is called usually the diffusion constant, and it depends on the density. I did not mention rho 1 or rho 2 because they are so close, so I just take this rho. And the other thing is that rho 1 equal rho 2, or even rho 1 slightly close to rho 2, qt squared. So I put a connected part if rho 1 is not equal to rho 2 will be given by another function, sigma of rho over L. And essentially the macroscopic fluctuation theory will use these two quantities. But these two quantities, in fact, they are related in a way which is what you can derive in a number of method. I will show you it in the case of temperature because it's slightly easier in 1 minute, but they are related to the free energy. So d of rho divided by sigma of rho times 2 is the second derivative of the free energy, where f of rho is the free energy per the free energy per unit length at density rho. So here, it's a free energy at equilibrium. So imagine you have a system at equilibrium at density rho. It has a certain free energy, and these two quantities are related. So in fact, there is really only one quantity which is new when you think about time dependence or transport, and the other one is just an equilibrium property. Okay, so let me just say how these things become in the case of temperature. The case of temperature, I will show you how they are related in the case of temperature in a minute, but essentially, when you look at a certain model, then the only thing you need to know are these two quantities. So for example, if I look at the CEP, then you can have D equal 1 if you choose the right time scale, and then sigma will be 2 rho, 1 minus rho. And essentially, to develop the macroscopic fluctuation theory, that is, if you want to know what is the large deviation function of the empirical measure of the density, or the position of the taxed particle, or whatever, essentially, this is only two things you need to know about this system. And if, for example, if you take random walkers, it will be just D equal 1, sigma equal 2 rho. And of course, non-interacting systems are easier. These are the cases that you can solve exactly. So these are cases where you can test that the macroscopic and the microscopic approach are results which are consistent. Okay, so this is really the starting point of this macroscopic fluctuation theory. You have these two properties, and so imagine that I look at reasonably small fluctuations of this current. So Q is just how much current you have, the integrated current during time t, so how many particles have crossed during time t. Then, of course, if you know the average and if you know the variance, then the thing you want to write is that the probability of Q for Q close to the average is given by a Gaussian distribution, so it will be minus Q minus D of rho times rho 1 minus rho 2 over L times T squared divided by 2 T sigma of rho L. So this is a kind of central limit theorem. I just say, okay, I know the average, I know the variance, and of course it looks a little complicated because I did not write the variance and the average, but I really use the formula which are here and to write it. And I write it this way because I am really going to show you that the macroscopic fluctuation theory can be fully understood just from this formula. Now, I said that sigma and rho are related by this expression, and if you work with temperature, there is a similar expression. And I am going to explain that in the case of temperature, because it is slightly easier, but the idea is very similar. So let me take system in contact with two heat baths. And here there is a length L. And then there will be a sigma over L times T1 minus T2, D times T1 minus T2, and there will be Q squared over T equals sigma over L. So I am very close to a certain temperature. This D and this sigma might depend on the temperature, but I don't write it explicitly. And now, how can I see that they are related? And this is fluctuation dissipation theorem, which is itself a consequence, or which can be derived from the fluctuation theorem. So yesterday I mentioned this fluctuation theorem, which says in the case of current of energy, that this is for large Q, which is Q times 1 over T2 minus 1 over T1. Okay, I did not put the Boltzmann constant. Yesterday, maybe I wrote it with the Boltzmann constant, so I take the Boltzmann constant to be 1. And now I just say this is the fluctuation theorem, so then I am not going to explain how it is derived. It will take half an hour or something like that. So I start from that, and I put this P of Q here inside this formula. Now you see this P of Q has three terms, Q squared, linear in Q, and constant. Now what you see is that if you make the ratio P of Q divided by P of minus Q, the quadratic term will drop, the constant term will drop, and the only thing which remains is the term linear in Q, when I make this ratio. So I have a term linear in Q that I can compute from there, which is just exponential 2d over sigma times t1 minus t2, and this should be like times Q. So and here I have Q times 1 over t2 minus t1. And of course, all this is supposed to be valid only when I wrote this kind of formula. So here I write the formula with T1 minus T2, everything depends on temperature. This formula is only valid when rho 1 minus rho 2 is small, or T1 minus T2 is small. So when T1 minus T2 is small, I compare the two things, and I get that 2d over sigma is 1 over t squared. So this is just to show you that these two quantities are related.
Yesterday you had the Boltzmann constant.
Okay, yes, but you see, in theoretical physics, we often don't put it. So if you put it, you would have a K here and a K there. Okay. I remember when I was a student, one of the first lectures I heard is that they wrote on the blackboard that h bar equals k equals I equals 1 and maybe equals 2 pi and so on. Okay, so. Okay, so now we can try to look at the macroscopic fluctuation theory. So here I use the temperature just to show this relation. In the case of the density, it's essentially the same story, but then you would have the compressibility, which is a derivative of the chemical potential with respect to the density, but essentially the reasoning is the same. Okay, so what I say is that you can do the same kind of things. Okay, so when you work with the density, in fact, I just say it very quickly because I did not want to enter with this free energy story, but you would have exponential Q times mu 1 minus mu 2, which is, this would be the fluctuation theorem. So you repeat the thing, and then you realize that f second of rho is just the derivative of the chemical potential with respect to the density. So essentially, it's the same thing. I just did not want to enter into the chemical potential and so on in here, but essentially, it's the same. Okay, so now I will start with that, and I will try to convince you how one gets the macroscopic fluctuation theory. And so really, this essentially started with the work of Bertini and De Solay, okay, and Claudio, who is here, London. And there are five of them, and Janelle Assigno, and I'm sorry, Gabrielli. Okay, I have all of them. Okay, so let me take a very large system of size capital L. I imagine that this very large system, I cut it into subsystems of size small l, but this size small l is itself very large. So in this small box, there are lots of particles. And I look at it over a certain time, t. So essentially, what I want to say is that I want to look at the system over a very big size, very big time, but essentially I want to cut the space and the time into boxes, and in each of these boxes, I want to use this formula. So the idea is that in this box, essentially the difference of density between the sides of the box will be small enough that essentially I can use this expression. So I am going to look at what this expression gives for this small box, and then I will sum the probabilities of all these boxes by saying what happens in the different boxes is independent, and then get that way the macroscopic fluctuation theory. So if you want, so you have this small L, which is very small compared to large L, but very large compared to the lattice size. And then I want to write L equals capital L times dx. So I have coordinate x will be between 0 and 1. And so L will be, small l will be capital L times dx. Now the system is diffusive. So I consider times which are very large, but very small compared to L squared, this small time. And I say this time t is L squared times d2. Okay, so these are the way. So both L and t are both very large, but they are small compared to the macroscopic scale. Now, I say that at the edge of these two points, here, macroscopic coordinate would be point x, here would be x plus dx, these two points. So I say that rho 1 minus rho 2 will be equal to minus rho prime of x dx. And I say that during this time t, the current, the integrated current, the flow of particles through this box will be a certain q, which is the true current times the time t. So it equals to j L squared d2. Okay, so really the only thing I want to do is to take these expressions and put them back into here. You see rho 1 minus rho 2 is here, q is there, and I put that in. And I do the calculation, so in fact it's not a difficult calculation at all. And there will be some dx, some d2s everywhere, some capital L and whatever you can imagine. But at the end, you get that this expression which is here, just this replacement, will be given by exponential minus L times the current plus d of rho prime squared over 2 sigma of rho times L times dx times d. So if you just do this replacement, you see you will have a t is, there is a d tau in the denominator, but there will be d tau squared in the numerator, there will be dx in a number here, in a number of places, but what you get is this. So this means that the cost, so you see, I started just from somehow some kind of central limit theorem. I said just, I know the average and the variance, so I wrote a Gaussian distribution for what happens for this system, and now I think that this system is just a very small part of a much larger system. And of course, the density at the two sides of the large system might be very different, but in this small box, the difference of density is always small, and so if it is always small, I can use this expression, and so I do the replacement. And now, if I want to ask what's the probability of observing a certain time-dependent profile over this whole box, then I have to sum over all boxes, and of course the sum with the dx and dito, they are at the right position. And so if I want to ask what is the probability of observing a certain density profile as a function of t and a certain current profile as a function of t, this will be given by exponential minus L integral dx, integral dt, dito, and then it will be small j plus d of rho, rho prime, squared over 2 sigma. And there is a L here, and when I wrote this, I made some kind of replacement. I replaced Lj by small j. So the true current is capital J, so really the number of particles which flow through them, but if I define this rescaled current J, then I get a formula and there is just a L here. So now I have something, so the time tau is going to go from zero to T over L squared. X is a macroscopic coordinate, and so this is the action that people use in the macroscopic fluctuation theory. So now, of course, that's not a mathematical proof, but it is just a way to make you feel that this action here just comes from the fact that in each box, you are using the fact that the density here is very close at the boundary of each elementary box. Now in the macroscopic fluctuation theory, you have a certain density profile, you have a certain current profile, so it's given for all x and all t. But in fact, these two fields are connected because there is a conservation law. And so this is one extra difficulty you have, is that d rho over d tau plus dj over dx equals zero. This is just expresses that the number of particles is conserved in the bulk. Okay. So really this is the content. Now, one way to think about it is the following. Please.
Is not from macroscopic fluctuation theory. This form you are proposing.
Okay, it would be if you take this expression and then you go in the situation where rho one minus rho two is small, then it would reduce to that. You see, I tried to make it feel. Now people like Claudio, they would derive this or something about the generating function. Yeah. So in principle, you look at a test functions which depend slowly on space and so on. So this and
I'm confused about the connection with that boxed formula you are just erasing. Does that come from macroscopic fluctuation theory? Or
no, In fact, this is just no. I think this is just a fluctuation dissipation theorem. This has to do with the macroscopic fluctuation. So for example, if you had a system which does not satisfy Fourier's law, I don't know, maybe anomalous Fourier's law, I guess. Okay, so I don't know whether there's anomalous fixed law, but imagine anomalous Fourier's law, so everything would be temperature here. So here you would have an exponent beta. Here you should have exactly the same exponent beta, and the two would always be related this way. So whether you take an ideal gas which does not satisfy that, it's still valid. That's because this is the fluctuation theorem, which has nothing to do with fixed law, Fourier's law, and all that. Now, another way of thinking about this formula, so if you accept it, then you can say that essentially you have a kind of Langevin equation. After all, the expression which is here is just a Gaussian. So the Langevin equation just simply means that the current J equals minus D of rho, rho prime. So this is Fick's law plus some noise, square root of sigma of rho over L over square root L times some white noise. If you say the current is given by this expression, and this is a white noise in time and space, then, okay, so you say that J plus D rho prime is just a Gaussian, and you end up with that. So it's essentially the same thing. It contains essentially the same information. Now, when I write it this way, you might worry that here I have So this is one part of the problem, and the other part is always the same, the conservation law. And then you might worry that, in fact, this is some kind of multiplicative noise, and then you say what prescription you should take, and probably in the room, half of the people will choose Ito, and the other half will choose something else. But it turns out that when L is very large, so this is a very weak noise, then... And this is not surprising, that when the system size is very large and the noise become weak, then the prescription you take does not matter. It would just matter at the level of higher corrections that nobody really tries to calculate in this subject. Now, one thing you can at least feel qualitatively from this picture is why you have long-range correlations. So here I have my system, and imagine I observe my system at time t equals zero, so I have a certain density profile, and the density profile has a certain position x, and that's a certain position y. They will be obtained from what you got in the past, but it will be influenced by the noise, so this is the arrow of time, but the noise which was present at a certain time in the past, at a certain position z. Because if I have a certain value of the noise at some time in the past, then I integrate this equation, and this noise will influence the density here and the density there. And so the small noise will have, say, for example, I make a linearized calculation, so the small noise will result in a linear deviation of the density at position x, a linear deviation of the density at position y, which both will be proportional to this noise, and when you make the average, you get the correlation. So essentially, you expect, and this is a way to calculate, in fact, these correlations, is that there will be some long-range correlations due to this fact. And from this point of view, the surprise that at equilibrium, then it is such that the long-range correlations disappear, because it seems to be very generic that there should be long-range correlations just for that. And of course, the macroscopic fluctuation theory, which is written here, does not care the way it is written. It does not care what you do on the heat baths at the boundary, so or on the reservoir. So it is in principle a theory which should apply to equilibrium. See, we talk about non-equilibrium, but equilibrium is a particular case of non-equilibrium. Okay. The second thing I want to say is that maybe I leave it as an exercise, which is what I've done here, that I have taken space in time, and I have discretized. But imagine now I am on the infinite line. So it's another remark, say. I am on the infinite line. Of course, I have no capital L to play with here. But still, I look at the system over a very long time T, so I take a time T. When I say very long, it means a kind of macroscopic time. It means that each particle had the time to jump many, many, many times. And now I repeat what I did here. I am going to cut space and time into boxes. So the boxes will be of size L, of length T in time, size L. And then because the system is diffusive, I want to say that capital T is very large. I want to say that the size of the boxes will be square root T times dx, and the time is capital T times d tau. Okay, so here I have in mind that T is very large, but small L is itself very large compared to one, and small t is also very large compared to one. So the d tau is very small, but not zero, because I will not satisfy. So now I just take this expression. I again assume that in each box, rho 1 minus rho 2 is equal to minus rho prime of x dx. And I do exactly the same thing I told you to do in order to reach this expression. Now there is no L in the game. And then what you get, okay, so let me write it here. Then what you get is exponential minus square root t times the integral from 0 to 1 d tau, the integral from minus infinity to plus infinity of dx of j square root t plus d of rho prime squared over 2 sigma of rho. Okay, so you see, again, when you do these replacements, you have dx, d tau almost everywhere, and then they simplify, and you end up with this. And very much like before, you see, it appears the only place where here we had L was here. The only place where we have the capital T is there. And so we have to consider on large scale a rescaled current square root t. So square root t times j. So this means that all, when you talk about these large deviation functions, all the current will be of order 1 over square root t, and all the cumulants will be of order square root t. You see, the square root t will be at the same place as L there. Okay, so this is just exactly doing the same replacement. Okay, so now, I want to play with this macroscopic fluctuation theory, which is here, but having in mind that it resembles very much a Langevin equation. So let me just come to the Langevin equation. Langevin equation. In the weak noise limit. So just, I have just erased it just a few minutes ago. You see, the macroscopic fluctuation is the same as saying that the current is given by fixed law plus some noise. So everything here depends on x and t times a white noise here. And rho and the current, they are related by this formula. Here it's one dimension. You could have the same in higher dimension. Okay, so really, and sorry, this is a square root L, and clearly, when the system size is large, it corresponds to a weak noise limit. So it's interesting to compare it. Of course, it's more complicated to simply the situation of a one-dimensional Langevin equation. It should be Q dot equals a certain F of Q plus noise, and here I put square root epsilon times a white noise. Okay. So I want to discuss a little bit of this, and I'm going to tell you that in some respects, a number of properties will be very similar in this case. So let me just consider a Langevin equation, and I take to start with the simplest situation, that the force is, if it's one infinite one-dimensional, any force will be the derivative of a potential, unless, for example, I take periodic boundary condition. If I do it on a ring, you might be out of equilibrium. So one can discuss this. I don't want to go into this detail. So I want just to look at the simplest Langevin equation. So imagine that I have a potential V of Q here, and the force here, for example, I have the origin, so the force here is zero at the origin. The force is just F of Q equals minus V prime of Q. V is the potential. And, so now I can ask very similar questions that we have discussed previously. And the first question is, what is the probability of observing a certain trajectory in space, which will be the equivalent of this action for the macroscopic fluctuation theory? And the equivalence of this action is, of course, given by exponential minus q dot minus f of q squared over 2 epsilon. And then you will go from time zero t. This will give you the probability of observing a certain trajectory. So really, this is the equivalent of that. Of course, it's simpler. You have a one-dimensional problem. Now, one question you can ask, if you ask the question A that I had at the beginning of this lecture, what is the probability of observing a profile? Here, what is the probability of being at a certain position, say Q1. So what's the probability of, if I look at the system at a given time, to be at a certain position Q1? So what's the probability observed that Q times, say, 0 is equal to Q1? Then, in principle, because there is an epsilon, it will be 1 over epsilon. Now if you are slightly educated in statistical physics and in Langevin equation, you would know from the very beginning what the answer here, and it should be, okay, so it would be a certain function g of q, and in fact, we will see that g of q is 2v of q. Is the potential, because you see the system is at equilibrium, what is the probability of observing certain deviation here is just given by the Boltzmann weight. The system is at equilibrium, so we know that in advance. Let's do as if we would not know what it is. Of course, if you start with this action, because epsilon is very small, then everything will be dominated by a single trajectory. So if I want to observe Q1 at time zero, I want to observe Q1 time zero, the system, what does this system do? Typically, the typical situation in weak noise is that it will sit at the bottom of the potential, and then there will be a trajectory to bring it here, and there will be another trajectory to bring it down when the fluctuation will relax. And so one way of trying to understand the probability of seeing a certain Q1 at time zero is just to identify this trajectory here. And of course, this is, if you look at it, this action depends on Q dot and on Q. So then you go back to what you have learned in classical mechanics. You have to find the optimal trajectory, which depends on Q and Q dot. So like you have with Lagrangian, then you know, or you remember, or you have to go back to a book or ask me at the end of this lecture how you do it, that when you try to minimize the integral over time of this, find the optimal trajectory, then this trajectory will satisfy dl over dq equals d over dt dl over dq dot. And then when you write this equation, you end up with the fact that it gives that q dot dot equals f of q, f prime of q, which means that q dot squared equals f squared of q plus constant. So the optimal trajectory, which is here, should satisfy this equation. This is just classical mechanics, because this quantity is like a Lagrangian. So it should satisfy this. Now, in the very long time limit, if I go very far in the past, it is at the bottom here. So f is zero, q dot is zero, so the constant is zero. This means that there are two solutions. There is q dot equals f of q, and q dot equals minus f of q. And in fact, these are the two trajectories. One trajectory is how the system relaxes. So very weak noise, the evolution would be just q dot equals f of q. And how you reach this fluctuation, then it will be q dot equals minus f of q. So in fact, this trajectory and that trajectory are exactly the same. And this is a property of equilibrium. And if you work, then if you work with the macroscopic fluctuation theory at equilibrium, you will get exactly the same. So the macroscopic fluctuation theory, instead of having q and q1, here you would have rho of x, and here you would have rho star of x. So the system would start from the steady state profile and then will produce a fluctuation, then it will relax. Now the way it relaxes, weak noise is just that j is equal to minus d rho prime, that's Fick's law. The way it is created is that j will be d of rho prime. I write it with j. Let me write it with, if j is given by this, then d rho over dt is equal to d over dx, because d rho over dt plus dj over dx is zero. So d rho over dt is d over dx, d of rho, d rho over dx. So this is how the system relaxes when you start with a fluctuation, and the way it the fluctuation is produced at equilibrium is d rho over dt equals minus d over dx, d of rho, d rho over dx. And the way to see it is technically slightly more difficult, because it's a field and there is a j, the rho, and so on. But essentially, the same thing, that when you try to find the optimum, then you find that you have to write some equation of this kind, and you find that the two solutions, one which relaxes and the other one which is where the fluctuation is created. Now, at this stage, maybe I want to make a remark, which is interesting, I don't know, for people who are not too familiar with it, is that, you see, here I ask what's the probability of observing a certain Q1, and I said, you start from the bottom, and then you let the fluctuation, and you go up there. And what is the optimal trajectory? Now, there is a problem at equilibrium, which is of the same kind, is what about if the potential is, for example, like this? Okay, so what would be the optimal trajectory, say, to go to Q1 here? And if you look at the action, you see that you need to climb that hill here. Okay, here it will cost you nothing because to go down, it's like when you ski down, you have to make no effort. So that part of the trip will cost you nothing, but this will cost you something, and this will cost you something also. And if you ask at first sight, if I look at the trajectory which goes from here to there, so let me call this point A, B, C, and final point D, I want to reach, the cost of this trajectory would be exponential minus VB minus VA over epsilon. Okay, there is a 2 here. The 2 comes from the normalization of the noise, so you should not worry about it. And there is minus 2 VD minus VC over epsilon. But because the system is at equilibrium, you know that the probability of observing this is just exponential minus VD minus VA over epsilon. And so somehow when you use this trajectory, you pay too much price here because you have first to climb this here and then to climb that here. So how to reconcile the two things? Okay, there are ways to reconcile it, but you see, trying to find the optimal trajectory does not give you the full answer if you don't think a little more about it. Yes, yes. In this case, also and in fact, this is a way to answer. This is a way to answer the question. Is that okay? Whatever you see, if you look at the system and you take a movie and see a certain fluctuation that going there, then you look at the movie backwards and it would show you how the system relaxes towards this. And now if you think that way, I start from here and I want to relax there. What happens to the trajectory? You go downhill very quickly, then you spend a lot of time here fluctuating until you jump over the barrier. Now you can ask, how long do I stay here? What is the typical time? How long I am going to stay here is exponential VB minus VC over, the two, forget the two, epsilon, just the time to jump this barrier here. Now, this means that to go from here to there, there is not a single trajectory. If you just start from here, there will be many, many trajectories. The number of trajectories is essentially proportional to the time you spend here. Typical trajectory, you go down, you wait a long time, and you go down. And in principle, you have an entropy effect, which is just you have to sum over all possible trajectories. And so this means that you have to pay a certain cost multiplied by the number of trajectories, and then you are safe, and you get the right answer. Okay, so this is an entropy effect, that's my understanding of it. Okay. So now let me just try. To ask, in fact, the simplest questions of all, which is, as I said, the empirical measure. In the case of the Langevin equation. So I have this Langevin equation, which I wrote, Q dot equals F of Q plus square root epsilon times eta, and now I want to fix a certain value of Q1, and I want to ask what's the probability that over a very long time t, the average of Q is given by a certain value of Q1. So, and the noise is very small. So essentially, what I am going to see is here I have Q of t, I have this time interval t, I have this Q1, and so essentially the system far in the past will be essentially at the bottom, and then it will come here, it will fluctuate and go down. And you remember that I said, okay, this is a possible picture, but it could happen situations where it does not do that. It achieves this average by spending part of the time here and part of the time there, and then that's another possibility. So of course, in the case of the Langevin equation, this is possible, and it's also possible in the case of the macroscopic fluctuation theory. So let me just, in the case of the Langevin equation, it's very easy to tell, because the thing is that you have to see what is the cost you have to pay to observe this. And the cost will be just exponential minus the action, Q dot minus F of Q, squared over 2 epsilon, sum from 0, sum over time of this. So if this capital time is very large, then of course you will have to pay a certain price proportional to the capital T in order to maintain the system here. And of course, the simplest thing you could imagine is to decide that you want just to stay close to this value Q1. So certainly the probability, this probability that the integral from 0 to t dt q of t equal q1 is certainly larger or equal to exponential minus t f squared of q1 over 2 epsilon. Because essentially, you say, if I want to just stay here for all the time, okay, maybe there will be some boundary effects which will not depend on this time capital T, but the price I have to pay is at least this. But you might be able to do something more clever by having a more time-dependent Q of T. And so in this case, it's rather easy to see that by expanding the thing which is there, is that if I expand the square here, I have exponential minus integral dt q dot squared from 0, from, okay, minus over 2 epsilon. I have okay, so I have this, I have the term which is q dot f of q over epsilon dt, and I have the f squared, minus this integral, plus this integral, minus f squared of q over 2 epsilon dt, and I want to make this, the argument of the exponential as large as possible. So this means that to make it as large as possible, it's easy here. I just do q dot equals 0, so I take something which does not depend on time. This, in fact, does not depend on the time because this is a full derivative, so this will not grow with capital T. And there is this term, and in fact, this term, it's rather obvious that if f squared of q is convex, then the easiest thing is that the best trajectory which will minimize everything will be f squared of q over 2. So the bound here will be the right answer if f squared of q is convex. But if it's not convex, then the situation might be more complicated. And for example, if you have a potential which has a double well like this, then if you want to achieve a certain value q1, empirical measure for Q1, the best to do is that to spend fraction of the time at this bottom,
fraction of the time at that bottom, and then essentially you will pay no cost. So in principle, this action will give you zero if you spend part of the time here and part of the time there. If you are a little more careful, then you have to do some instanton calculation, and then you will find that this probability in a situation like this will be something like exponential minus t, and there will be something like one exponential, sorry, maybe it will be very small. So it will be exponential 1/ε, and then to compute that is more tricky, and I don't want to enter this thing. But essentially, you see that the optimal trajectory to optimize this in such a potential, so when f squared of q is not convex, it's essentially to stay in these two, minima. So you have exactly the same theory about fluctuation, macroscopic fluctuation theory. But you see, if I take this macroscopic fluctuation theory, so this Langevin equation, if I take this Langevin equation and I ask what is the empirical measure to see that, and I am in a situation which is nice where f squared of q is convex, still you have some interesting question about how you settled this quasi-stationary steady state, how it relaxes, and all these things can be calculated. And in fact, this is some work that we are doing with Tridib. And for example, you can ask, what is the optimal trajectory here at time zero? What is the value here when epsilon is small? And this, for example, takes the value q1 plus f of q1 over f prime of q1. I hope I have not forgotten the factor two. Maybe I can check it. No, yes, there is a factor two in the denominator. So this is, even in the case where f squared is convex, you can ask what is the position here, how it would fluctuate, what are the fluctuations there, and so on. You have many questions, and as I said, this is some work in progress with Tridib for the macroscopic fluctuation theory, where we ask exactly the same thing. You want to see an empirical profile here, how this profile was built, how it relaxes, what are the fluctuations. Okay. Let me consider this situation, a system of size L, and then I ask, what is the probability that during time t, a long time t, I observe a certain current J? Okay, so this is, okay, so this means that the integral over t of the current J of x and t is given, J1. Okay, so what's the probability that the integral of this current? And in fact, it does not really matter where I observe the current because all the particles which enter here cannot accumulate and they live on the other side, so I can choose any coordinate x and the result does not depend on that. Now, the easiest thing to imagine is that this, the current itself, will be constant in time. So let me just try to look at events of this kind. So the typical current that the system wants to achieve is here. Now I want to observe J1 over a certain time window, capital T, which is large. Then the system would do that. It might do more complicated things, very much like we discussed when F squared of Q was not convex. It might decide to achieve this current by doing some oscillations, big oscillations around that or whatever. But the easiest thing to assume that this current will be time independent. And then this is what we assume with Thierry Bodino to calculate this large deviation functions. And then Claudio and his collaborators, they have found some conditions for this to happen, very much like the condition I discussed about f squared of q being convex. Now, if we do that, then the probability, if j here does not depend on time, and of course, if it does not depend on time, it cannot depend on the position, because the integral does not depend on x, then of course here I have to find the optimum, but now with a constant j. So I have to find the optimum exponential minus, then there is L times 0 to 1 dx times 0 to t over L squared, and now I have just j1 plus d of rho prime squared over 2 sigma of rho. And now the big thing is that j1 does not depend on time. If j1 does not depend on time, then the density also does not depend on time. So this rho does not depend on time, but it still depends on x. But if nothing depends on time, then this integral I can forget and replace it by minus t over L. And now I have just to find the optimal profile for a given j1. But finding the optimal profile with a given j1 is again a problem that we looked at before. We said in classical mechanics, you have to find the optimal trajectory function of q and q dot. Here, I have to find the optimal density profile, but it's a function of rho of x and rho prime of x. It's really, instead of being q of t and q prime of t, in classical mechanics, or what we looked at in the Langevin equation, now we have to find the optimal profile, but the optimal profile is just, we have to optimize this quantity with respect to rho of x and rho prime of x. Same story, this means that you can use the classical mechanics to solve this problem, and this is the way we can get closed formulas for this thing, for the fluctuation of the current. Okay, so I see that I have 40 seconds more. I won't use them, and I will say a few more things about the macroscopic fluctuation theory tomorrow at the beginning. Especially, I will mention some open questions, and I will talk a little bit about phase transitions, and then I will discuss some microscopic models. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you. So time for questions.
You spoke about the empirical measure and the trying to find probability when you have the two well potential. You said that when you want to look at the position between the two wells, then probably you have a convex combination, something like a times in one of the two wells. But then is a large deviation principle enough to be able to find these coefficients?
The coefficients are very, you see, the fraction of, you see, if you have the two wells, yeah, okay, and you want to achieve Q1, so this is say, QA and QB, okay, and so you want the integral of Q of T to be Q1, the average of Q of T to be Q1. Okay, then you are going to spend a fraction of time TA in QA plus TB in QB in such a way that this is Q1, then TB plus TA is capital T. So you do, okay, at that level, to know the fraction of time you will spend on the two minima, that's easy. What is difficult is that if the time is very, very long, then the system from time to time will hop from here to there and come back and so on. And this is where you need to do some instanton calculation.
this fixed law that you mentioned is linear in the gradient of the density.
Yes.
Now suppose I have more nonlinear terms added in general. Will the probability distribution that you wrote down...
So fixed law is linear when it's different. Fixed law says that the current is minus d of rho times rho prime. So this means that I am in a situation where rho A minus rho B is very small. But if rho A minus rho B is not small, then the result is not linear, it's linear plus quadratic and so on.
That's right. Okay,
so in general, although you have fixed law, the current is not just linear function. But now you could say, what about if the current is maybe minus rho prime cube or something like that? So that I don't know, is that a bit totally sorry.
So, I mean, again, for like, supposing I have a system with anomalous transport. So, I mean, if I tried to do the same steps as you did here, like, which step would go wrong? Is it the, which step would go wrong? Like, I could do a different scaling in time, right? I mean, for example.
I am not sure. Certainly, this macroscopic fluctuation theory does not work. I am not really an expert, but maybe one thing which went wrong, is the following, is that, you see, when I try to derive the large, the macroscopic fluctuation theory, I have taken boxes in space and time, and I looked at how much it costs for an individual cell here, and then I said that what happens in this cell and that cell, I make the product of what happens on all these cells. So somehow, okay, I guess this is certainly something which is not obvious, that what happens in all these cells is uncorrelated in time and in space. Okay, so that's maybe a reason. But of course, you see, I would find it extremely interesting that all we can calculate for diffusive system one do in the case of anomalous diffusion.
Can you provide some more details, elaborate a bit on the instanton approach? How is it set up? I mean, just to sort of know some more details.
I did not prepare it, so I would need to load my remote memory. One way to do it, of course, is to write a Fokker-Planck equation. You see, if you write the Langevin equations, then you can write immediately a Fokker-Planck equation. Now, the Fokker-Planck equation, when you want to condition on a quantity like this, and this I will try to explain it tomorrow in terms of Markov process, but when you want to condition on it, this means that the Fokker-Planck equation gets deformed. And if you want to see the details of that, for example, there is this review by Touchet who explains it very well. So essentially, you have a Fokker-Planck equation which is deformed that you have to solve. And essentially, you have to find the largest eigenvalue of this Fokker-Planck equation. Now, trying to find the largest eigenvalue of the Fokker-Planck equation is very similar to what people do, for example, when they try to see the splitting in quantum mechanics when you have a double well. So because the Fokker-Planck equation is very much like a Schrödinger, and so and this is a way to do it.
Sorry, one last question. Is there, very naive, is there a version, is there hope for a version of this for systems with ballistic transport?
Okay, the ballistic transport is somehow rather trivial in all this story. So, okay, it's not diffusive, so this story would not work. But then, you see, if you take, okay, the simplest case of ballistic transport is just the ideal gas. Okay, the ideal gas, if you want to know the profile at a given time, you can just look particle per particle. Each particle contributes independently. So you can, this is a case where the microscopic calculation is really straightforward. To see it, you see, even for example, okay, so let me deviate. But for example, if you just take random walkers, okay, so which is diffusive, then in principle, you can do all this. And the story looks complicated. You have to have this J of X and T and so on. It looks complicated. When you look at it from the microscopic point of view, you have independent particles. It's very easy. So I would say that for ballistic, like ideal gas, I would start with the microscopic approach.
No other questions? So I have just one question. You start with the infinite system. You get a large deviation function, large deviation principle, and in the large deviation function, you make a quadratic approximation using fluctuation theory. Can you proceed, and then you develop your machinery. Can you do it in the other way, that is, start with the stochastic process on the infinite line and make a quadratic Gaussian approximation of the process itself and try to get the conservation law into, to keep the conservation law in the picture, and that develop an analogous machinery. Can you, in some sense, exchange the fact that you start with the a large deviation principle at the level of the process and then approximate the rate function with exchange with the fact that you could approximate the process by a Gaussian, more Gaussian process, and have already at hand a quadratic expression for your for rate function? I don't know if the question is clear.
I am not sure. I think the microscopic process is certainly not Gaussian, and there is all these works that, my mathematician colleagues are able to do, which is to really show that a formula, this one or some formula which is equivalent to this one, appears at large scale, very much like central limit appears when you add many. So you see, they start from a process which is not Gaussian, which is the true process, not approximated, and then they get this as a kind of central limit theorem. This is my understanding, you see, of what they are doing. My understanding as a physicist is essentially what I have shown here, which is certainly not good enough for mathematicians.
No other questions? So if